5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
When I had come down this hill, I had seen this creature cross the road. It would have ripped my locked door from my truck, extracted me from my vehicle, and there wouldn't have been a damn thing I could have done about it.
This thing, I got to notice its eyes. Its eyes was real, real evil, real sinister looking. The look it was giving me.
What are you reporting?
Jesus Christ, you better... Sir? Neil!
Hello?
Get somebody out here.
What's going on now, sir?
That son of a bitch is about 6'9", I don't know.
Do you see him now, sir?
Yes, I'm looking right at him.
Uh-oh.
Welcome to Sasquatch Chronicles, a place where people share their encounters. Let's start the show. Welcome to the show, everyone. Thanks for being here tonight. Got a great show planned for you this evening. Going to be talking to Joseph, who's a paramedic out in Texas. And had a pretty scary encounter out there. He had a flat tire in the middle of the night when his ambulance broke down and he ran into these creatures. And it's a really interesting encounter, especially since Joseph didn't really believe in these creatures prior to his encounter. And being a paramedic, you know, the guy's seen, I would imagine, some pretty bad things on the job and then running into this thing. So look for that here in a moment. If you've had an encounter and you'd like to be on the show, shoot me an email, wes@sasquatchchronicles.com. And I want to welcome two guests tonight. We got Bob Garrett coming back. Bob, thanks for coming on tonight. I really do appreciate you being here.
Oh, you're welcome, Wes. I really do enjoy coming on the show.
And we have a very special guest. I know Joseph, he's a paramedic out there in Texas. And I got to tell you, Joseph, when I read the encounter, I couldn't wait to talk with you. I honestly couldn't wait to talk with you. And, you know, I called Bob and I was like, hey, Bob, you got to hear this one. Bob was gracious enough to come on and share his thoughts on the encounter. But if you would kind of start from the beginning, just kind of tell us what you were out doing and then walk us right into the encounter. And then, Bob, you're welcome to ask away. My home is your home, so feel free to ask questions. And then when we get done with the encounter, Joseph, if you want to ask Bob any questions, you know, feel free to.
Sure. First and foremost, I just want to say I'm definitely happy that Bob Garrett is here. And Wes, thank you for having me on the show. Well, let me just get right into it, I guess. Let me give a little statement of myself, I guess, so the audience can get to know who I am. I am a emergency paramedic. I work in the Coastal Bend region, and we cover all that region. From South Texas to East Texas to every part of Texas. So anyhow, that night we're winding down a 24-hour shift. And with our company, that shift consists of 911 calls and transfers to different hospitals around Texas. So after about our eighth call, we got called out to do a transfer to the Houston area of a patient. We finish up that transfer, and we weren't allowed to escape the ER because now we caught a transfer for a patient going to residence. So that happens from time to time, especially with EMS. You'll catch a patient going to residence. Me and my partner took the patient in the back of the unit, got our vitals, everything we had to do. I got my patient history. My partner jumped in the front, and he punched into his phone the residence of his patient. So 9 times out of 10, taking a patient to the residence shouldn't take more than 3-4 hours tops sometimes, you know, because Texas is such a large piece of land. I mean, Texas is huge, but there's no busy highways out in the country, which is where this patient lived. And he was an older gentleman, nice gentleman. Anyhow, we took the patient to the residence. It's on the way back when all this started to happen. Now, to set the atmosphere, it's around 3:30 a.m. when my partner admitted to me that he had taken a wrong turn. Because as the paramedic, the lead paramedic, we depend on our drivers and also other medics as well, usually to know more of the routes and locations. But I can tell you this was in the East Texas area, in the outskirts of the Humble area. I would need to talk to my partner to get a more definitive location. And it was off, I believe, the initial highway we took was 59. We had taken a paved road. I do remember we took a dirt road, and it led to another paved road that was going down one way. And there was woods on each side. Within that route, we got a flat tire, which was a surprise to us, surprise to me, because that unit was a brand new unit with brand new tires, but it happened. So we both get out of the unit. My partner reaches over to my end of the unit. I was already out of the unit. I was lighting a cigarette, and he sets off the siren, reaching for the flashlight. So I'm like, okay, I shut it off. Now, in those units, we have a 210 jack that would lift the unit up with that 210 jack, and we'll make an attempt. Dispatch was already advised. We advised dispatch as soon as it happened, without a doubt. And we also contacted a supervisor and told them, hey, we're in this location. This is where this is going on. We got a flat. We're going to attempt to go ahead and pump up the tire. Or we have a spare tire, rather, put the spare tire on. We're having an issue with one of the bolts. During that, the whole process for working, we heard what sounded like footfalls, bipedal footfalls. I would have to say, if I had to make a guess, within a 2-2.5 mile range. And at first, when we were hearing it, it was so faint that we didn't even make an issue of it. Our goal was trying to get out of here so we could get back to the station, clock out, go home, or retire. So at the end of a 24-hour shift. And if you guys ever worked a shift like that, if you want to go home. After a while, it was my turn to give it a shot for the tire, and that's when the footfalls got a little bit louder, a little bit louder. The only thing I can liken it to would be maybe when it got pretty close, the way it kind of felt, about how the girth and the how large it was would be like the footfalls of an elephant, maybe. I was already bent down, squatting down, undoing this bolt when it got that close. And it seemed like it did it quickly. Because we weren't there for about less than 10 minutes when it let out this scream that I can only describe as a gorilla's bark mixed with a lion times 50. I felt this thing when it screamed. Initially, I felt every organ in my body vibrate. Imagine your liver vibrating, a kidney. That's how much this sound it made. That's when we got scared. I got scared. I'm not afraid to admit it. We got back in the unit. He was shaking. I was shaking. I told him to turn everything off except the floodlights. In that, his hands were shaking so much. He let off the code 3-1, which is when you go to a 911 call, you see the red and white and blue lights. He let off those. I shut them off. In the process of shutting them off, I felt like something menacing was at my side of the window. Because he jumped in the driver's side, I jumped in the passenger side. But it's 3:45 a.m. Now it's probably reaching almost a 4 o'clock hour during this, when it was reaching its climax. When I turned around, and what I saw distinctly was a monster standing there. And this thing had already thrown, when this thing screamed at us, and we felt this go through our body, it had thrown something at the unit. When my partner jumped in the passenger seat after that initial vocalization and this thing throwing, the initial rock, he jumped on his seat. And as soon as he shut his door, something else hit that door. He looked in the mirror. He knew that there was a log, and I was half the same circumference. It was about 8 inches in circumference, and it was the Y part of a tree. Sorry, guys. Just getting into this gets me a little bit.
No, you're good.
It brings me back, and I don't like to be having a chance to. Well, anyway, this thing, when I turned around, was staring at me. I was staring at it. If I had to describe it, it would be what you imagine Shaquille O'Neal, longer arms, buffed out. Hair was about 2 inches long, jet black. Looked like a chimp. If I had to describe the facial features, it had a hooded nose, but it was punched in like Mike Tyson hit it a couple times. Or Evander Holyfield had punched the crap out of that nose. Yeah. Red eyes. I will never forget the eyes. It opened its mouth at me, curling its lips and snapping its jaws, moving it from side to side. Now, let me tell you guys something. I was brought up a 911 paramedic. I've gone to almost every scene you could think of. I'm talking PD calls for traumatic-wise. A lot of people couldn't handle that and keep their cool, and then at the same time start delegating medical treatment. Let alone cardiac arrest, and the whole family's there watching. I can keep my cool, and I credit myself for keeping my cool, but in the average medic. But when I saw that thing, for lack of a better term, I thought, and that's why I do feel anger towards these things, this humanoid thing that's something out there, I felt like it took my manhood. I felt like I was, and when you are scared, and when you truly are, you are going to freeze. I don't care if you're a tough guy, or what you say you've done, or what you have done. When something like that, when you're trying to figure out what it is, and you can't, you're going to freeze.
So you're looking at this thing from the inside of the truck, and you see it. What is the creature doing?
It's shifting its weight from side to side. Hands dangling at the side. Not too much movement. I would have to say every time it shifts its weight, its hands would swing maybe a quarter of an inch, something like that. It was moving. The whole body was in movement. At the same time, it was curling its lips up. I would notice, the thing I noticed the most about this creature, Wes and Bob, it looked like it had lived a difficult existence. It looked like it was hungry. It looked like, I don't know if when we let off the siren, because I've had 7 months to think about this, and this happened probably mid-May. And thinking about this, I'm thinking that maybe we interrupted it from eating. Or maybe even ourselves, once we acknowledged our presence, we were on the menu, as Wes would put it. 5 seconds, I'm frozen. I snap out of it. It's like my first responder character kicked in. And when I snapped out of it, I started telling my partner to get on the radio, and I started locking the doors. I think that thing didn't like that. I don't think it liked the fact that I think it felt disrespected or something. Because within seconds after I snapped out of it, because I'm thinking about our lives, all of a sudden you felt a big bang hit the side of the unit. And we felt ourselves being elevated within the unit. And I landed on my partner's side. His poor body squished against his window. And we're thinking we're going to go over. My heart's in my throat. I bet my heart rate probably was at 120 easy, maybe a little bit higher, man, if that's what this was going on. It let go. The truck landed safely on its base. The tire popped the hell off, bent the whole bottom half of it. Damage to that, the damage to the cabin, it cracked the whole box, all the internal damage. Everything in the truck was on the fritz and not working. Efficiently. This was, of course, everything I discovered more in detail after it happened. When we landed directly on our tires, I ended up being halfway within my seat, kind of like propping myself up, and I was even afraid. I know I was bruised up from all that, but I was so scared still that once we landed, I stayed in whatever position God granted me through the forces of gravity, whatever position I was in, I just stayed in it. And I do remember that I just kept my eyes facing down because what this thing did, Wes, Bob, or these things, started making a freaking racket. Kind of like they're celebrating the fact that this one had the balls to hit our unit. Huh. Loud, like, making a racket.
When you say a racket, what do you mean by racket? Like, what were they?
Sorry. Branches being broken, more screams, more roars. Almost like a gorilla chimp type mix. Especially some of the butts. And then all of a sudden, you would get this scream, and then branches being broken all around it, around us. We were surrounded. And if you or anybody has ever been in anything that where you almost get into an accident, and then all of a sudden things start screaming at you, I'm sorry, I don't know anybody that's going to be like, hey, let me jump out of this thing. What's going on here? No.
Yeah, I don't blame you. I would have stayed in there, too.
Yeah.
What they wanted you to do was get out. That's what they wanted you to do. Because, yes, you probably were on the menu. You probably weren't at first. But they were probably going to cross right in there. And, mm-hmm. and y'all had your bad luck to have the bad tire.
Yeah.
And once y'all got out, they probably decided that they were going to put y'all on the menu. These that you're describing are quite volatile.
Mm-hmm.
And I would imagine what they were trying to get you out of the truck. Because for some reason, you know, sometimes people will actually jump out and run to try to get a situation. And that's when you're taken down.
Right.
So you did the right thing by staying inside. And yes, they're pretty powerful. They could have turned that thing over if they had wanted to.
I agree. No, thank you, Bob. I mean, it's funny you say this because I kind of felt like we're a can of sardines. You know, like we're literally in the can of these. Like it felt that way because the way this thing was looking at me and slapping its face at me, it wanted it. I got kids, you know. I wanted to. I felt they wanted to take a chunk of my freaking arm off, and every cell in my body, I felt. That's what I say to people. I haven't talked about this to too many people. My wife, two other coworkers I've worked with for many, many years. I didn't feel like a human being with a single stand on me. I felt like I was a roast. if you understand.
When the creature first stepped out, what was it doing? When you looked at it, the floodlights are on, and you're sitting and looking at this thing.
It was covering its eyes from the lights. The lights had the code 3 lights. And it snapped in its jaw every couple seconds. And it had a black mouth. Canines, not really, really pronounced, but pronounced enough where you get to point what they are. I remember when these things were screaming at us and we landed on our face, my only visual could be the middle console of the truck, which I could see my computer and I could see my partner's fingernails digging deeper and deeper and deeper and deeper into the seat. Every time these things started to work up one of their roars. I had a question for Bob, if possible.
Yeah.
Yeah, of course. Of course.
Bob, you don't think by chance that these things could recognize me or maybe anything, they have any recall with people by chance? Because it gets to the point where, and also, do you think the siren had any bearing initially? Sorry.
The sound, yeah, would. I didn't quite catch all that. I'm sorry you broke up. But I think you're asking me if did the sound annoy them? Is that basically what you're saying?
Yeah, the sound, and if these things maybe have any recall with people they fuck with, for lack of a better term. Sorry.
Yeah, the sound, I'm quite sure if you had your siren on, yeah, they didn't like that at all. And I'm sure they didn't like those lights either.
Yeah.
And one thing, it can make them angry, volatile, for to have that loud noise going like that. I mean, you know, it puts a shiver up my spine too. But
yeah.
as far as the, you were talking about the bright lights that was shining in their eyes,
yeah,
or shining in this one's eyes,
yeah,
that's a good thing. As a matter of fact, that might have given you or given them a, you know, back off signal. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Yeah, because they don't like that bright light at night. And that's what I try to always tell everybody. Always, you know, if you're out in the field, always keep a floodlight with you, because you put that in their eyes. They do not like that. And nine times out of ten, they'll stop. You know, that stops you. But however, like you said, you know, showing their teeth and doing all that screaming and everything,
yeah,
that's pretty volatile action, behavior. And I think that y'all are very lucky that they didn't come through your windshield, or they didn't come through the door, because, you know, a black bear can pull a door right off. Well, they're
right.
Massive. These things are massive. Even though they're streamlined, the ones
yeah.
that you're talking about here, they can pull your door off. They have a superhuman strength. I mean, they can literally pull your door off. I have seen them roll big boulders over. Like an old grizz does, and you know, to eat moss that are underneath of it. That bright light
mm-hmm.
is probably what saved your life, I would imagine, because, yes, you were on the menu. After y'all stopped and after y'all got out
mm-hmm.
and everything that went on, y'all were definitely on the menu. Y'all were easy take, easy prey.
Yeah, I agree with you, because that's exactly how it projected itself towards us. I you know, in hindsight, I also thought all the IVs we've been starting all day and all the blood content in their hazards in the back, those things are probably smelling blood too.
The other question he's asking, Bob, I think what
okay.
Joseph was asking was, if these things, would they recognize him if he's back in the area?
Right.
They will recognize the ambulance, and if
yeah.
you get out of your ambulance,
yeah.
They may recognize your scent if it's the same ones. I have known people who, I mean, I'm not trying to scare you, and this
mm-hmm.
wouldn't happen to you, but I have known people who live in the areas that
right.
have gone out and you know, messed around with these things, food out, and didn't put the food out, like, you know, like they should have, and this thing and that thing, and they've actually followed people, you know, a mile, 2 miles to their homes. So they would know you. Yeah, they have long memories, from what I've observed.
Right. Bob, I ask you, and I'm sorry to interrupt, but I ask you because I put in for a transfer from that area. It was getting to the point, I would get nightmares every night. I was waking up in the unit in the ambulance. I would turn my head, and its face was right there at the glass. The recurring dream, the growl also. I'm hearing it from time to time. I'll be working on a report late hours in the unit. I'm in a populated area, but at night, with the windows up, and I'll hear the growl, and it'll send my my spine. I can feel it up and down my spine. I never wanted to look when we took those calls out in the country, Bob. Was I never wanted to look after that? This is what happened to us that night. I never wanted to look to either side of the window when we'd be en route in these country roads. I just didn't want to look at the woods, you know.
I know what you're talking about. This isn't going to leave you very soon, believe me. This is going to stay with you. It has with me. It has with my sons. You know, we've had situations where we that were pretty bad, and we still dream about it. We still have nightmares about it. So
I know this is going to, I don't feel this is ever going to leave, because once you realize that this is, because I was the type of guy, this was my big point of whatever, it's a joke. And I wasn't a believer. I this is what made me a believer. This is because it happened to me. And then, if I don't know if the rest of society that realizes, if there's a humanoid type creature living in the outskirts and the fringes of Texas, and then this is something that obviously has enough intelligence to keep itself hidden, God knows what else could be out there.
Well, you know? that's true. And the thing about it is that I hate to tell you this, but you just came to the realization that there's real monsters in this world.
Yeah.
And they're not as far, they're not as far off the road as you think they are.
No way.
So for the listeners out there, I wanted to kind of wrap up the story. So you're in the thing, you're in the ambulance, and they're vocalizing. How did you eventually get out of there?
Oh, we didn't leave the ambulance. The vocalizing, all the racket eventually ended. The supervisor started reaching my partner and me on the cell phone. We gave him a better definitive location where we're at. He showed up with enough unit lights blaring. Once he approached me and he saw the damage, right away he thought that we had crashed into something or what, you guys hit a tree or whatever. And I took him to the side and I explained to him what happened. He looked at me like I was crazy. And they suspended me for a week. So, needless to say, for, I guess, insurance purposes, I had to later say to other people it was a bear. So, that's where that ends.
I'm sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off. I was just curious. The supervisor didn't notice anything?
Oh, no. I think the supervisor knew very well in hand what had happened. This guy had been working this area for 25 years.
Okay.
Yeah. He just projected towards me as if, you know what, dude, I'm going to come off, and if you pursue this, I'm going to tell everybody you're nuts. This is a bear, and that's all. Because I think if more first responders came out, especially the ones that work in the outskirts, it would be a major issue, and there would be a reaction.
Yeah.
So I was basically told to shut the hell up about it. I'm taking a risk just having this interview, but after this had happened to me, I researched everything new I could, and your show came out, and I listened to your encounter, Woody, and Bob's name came out independently. I learned about Bob first, and then I realized you guys would communicate. But of everything out there, you're the only ones that came off genuine for me to even take the chance.
I appreciate that, man. I appreciate that very much. You know, it's it's a scary, you know, I'm with Bob. I kind of think they were trying to get you out of that car for whatever reason. I think, and Bob kind of made a good point earlier when him and I were talking, and I don't know if Bob caught up on it, but it made me really stop and think. You know, there's a lot of missing people out there, and they'll find their cars, but it's like the person vanished. The door's open, and it's like the person vanished. And it makes you wonder, you know, could it have been a similar type of situation you were in? You know, if you guys would have ran, I think they would have ran you down.
Yeah, you know, from the first time I think about it, I tell myself, did I lose control? And, you know, with Bob's reassurance and some of the stuff you told me about when we spoke before we did the show, about what happened with those hardcore biker guys, I kind of felt a little bit better, because I kind of felt like it had taken me as far as me, because you got to be an alpha male to do first responder work. You have to be, because you have to take control. And I felt that it felt like it had taken some of that away from me. And I had a question for Bob, though. real quick, Wes.
Yeah, go ahead.
When they threw the stones at us initially, and they screamed at us, were they trying to? Were they trying to kill us, or were they trying to scare us?
Initially, they were trying to make you run. It's like a predator. They're predators. They're okay. Apex predators, and they want you to run. If you run, they will chase you, and they will take you. They will run you for as long as they can. Until the fun is over with, and then they will take you. And once they take you, they'll break your bones.
Yeah, probably consume us.
That's what they were trying to do. That's exactly what they were trying to do. Was get you to run. They weren't trying to. Now this isn't a situation, Wes, where. You know, like with me and you, when they were trying to get us to back off. This is a situation where this man's life was in total danger, and they were trying to get him to run. They wanted them to run, and, so they could take him. These guys are lucky to be here right now.
Yeah.
I don't mean to scare you, but I've seen these situations before. And have come up across them before, and this is what they do. Y'all were out there on a dark road. Y'all were broke down. This is right up their alley, and they were right there.
If we were around, you're probably absolutely right. This thing probably would have just. But we're trained instinctively to get back in our units. We're trained instinctively to advise, communicate. Once it initially happened and we landed, the radio wasn't working anymore, so we had to depend on phones, and the phones were spotty with the reception out there. So it was down to the point where I was even thinking at one point that these things are just toying with us and they're just eventually, but we were probably there after the wheels landed. And we were there in fear, continued for about a total 45 minutes before the other supervisors showed up. And I do feel that they were there the whole time. And when the other paramedics and EMS crew showed up, I think that they took off. I don't think they liked that. Because I felt they were there the whole time, probably. And then as soon as everybody else arrived, I felt they took off because. They're waiting for us to step out of the vehicle. Is it safe now? And then they would have taken us. But I know my partner, because the gentleman I was working with, hell of a kid. He was 22 years old, his first year in EMS, and imagine how he's going to feel. My regular partner had called in sick, so I worked with this guy. And I feel sorry for him a lot because I'm thinking, wow, it's first year in EMS, and he gets attacked by a freaking monster, man. We almost died.
How does he feel about the whole thing?
I don't want to say denial, but he doesn't want to even bring it up. Just for me to try to communicate him earlier today, it was like pulling teeth just to help me get the location for y'all. And he was just, didn't want to say a word. But eventually he talked a little bit about it. No, he breaks down crying, man. He breaks down crying. He quit. Uh-huh. He's no longer there.
Well, I don't blame him because I've been in situations that I didn't think I was going to get out of, and it's still with me, and it's still going to stay with you guys. But I wish there was some way that we could help your partner or something. It's going to take a while for him to relax and settle that down. It's going to be in your dreams. This is like I said, you guys just realized that there are real monsters in the world.
You know, this got me thinking about the bikers. Remember the bikers down there in Texas? And what pisses these? Why did the Sasquatch get so pissed when these guys go down the road? And if you think about it, loud noise. I mean, I have bikers drive up and down on the road by my place. And it rattles the windows, and it just kind of irritates me when I hear them drive up and down. And I would imagine these guys turning on the code 3 lights, the sirens. No wonder why the whole thing was charged. You know, the ambulance was charged.
Yeah, the atmosphere was very volatile, and that's probably one of the reasons why. It's because it started out just like that.
You know what, Bob? The aggression is a little bit like these things have psych issues, man. I mean, these things are like suffering out there or something. And I think they should. I mean, I hate to sound like a bad guy to the audience, but I don't think they I think it should be eliminated of, at least put out. I mean, if they're suffering at this point, I don't know what purpose they help in as far as the structure, the ecostructure of the forest or whatever, but I don't know what purpose do they serve besides a threat to us. You know, if it's suffering out there, I don't know. I think they should all be shot, to be honest with you. Someone's going to end up getting killed.
Yeah, I think that's happened a few times. One thing I wanted to ask you, Joseph, and you and I had talked about yesterday, you had mentioned, I know it looked kind of like a retarded chimp and half human when you were looking at this thing. Sure. One thing I wanted to kind of address with Bob, and maybe Bob could answer it. I don't know if he can or not, but you had mentioned it had patches of fur missing.
Yeah, it had patches of fur throughout its body, on the upper torso, on the hind legs, kind of like a dog with mange, sort of, because the skin was a dark, dark gray, almost a dark purplish. It looked like it had some sort of mental difficulty because it did resemble a child with Down syndrome. Its mouth was black, hooded nose, but yet flattened. Some neck, it does have some neck, but the traps on this thing are so huge that if you saw this thing, you would not, you'd think, oh my God. Like I said, this thing was, well, if the best way to describe this thing would be Shaquille O'Neal, buffed out, 2-inch fur throughout the body, longer, yeah. Thin, though, around the waist. It thinned out pretty thin around the waist. And it lived in patches of fur as if, I don't know, it had cancer. I mean, this thing looked, it looked like dread. The noises it made sounded evil, and this thing had this, like, its face just looked evil. Everything about it just looked like we had pissed it off. It wanted to eat us. Jesus Christ. This thing, it's affected my life in a good way. I wish it would have never happened. Any of it. I was better off not knowing and being ignorant. If someone could come up to me tomorrow and say, hey, will you want to have ignorance again? I'll say, give me ignorance, please.
Yeah.
Well, I
go ahead, Bob. See, what's your take?
I was just going to say that, you know, I wanted to tell him that, you know, I believe him 100% because his description of these creatures is almost right on. And also, you know, you were talking about their grayish blue skin. Yes, that's what they do. They have the ash colored skin, and sometimes it can be blue. As far as the hair being missing. It's a possibility that there is mange there, but it's more likely these type that you're talking about here and what he's talking about, Wes, they fight among themselves, and they will pull patches of fur or hair out of themselves. They will eat their own. These things are very volatile. I have no name for them. I don't know. I just, like me and Tim and the guys, you know, we just call them reruns because they're just so damn crazy looking. And like you said, they do, they have a face that only a mama could love. Oh my God. They're just scary looking, and they are. They look like a cross between a chimp and a human being. They didn't cross well, but they will. They'll fight between each other, and they'll fight with the others that are out there, and they will actually kill and eat their own. These things are pretty bad. You know, I don't go into this too much. As a matter of fact, I've only done it in private with you, but I'm telling you, my friend, you're very lucky that y'all got out of there. I mean, I don't want to scare you, like I said, but it just gives me cold chills thinking about what y'all went through, and I don't think y'all are going to be over this for a while.
No, the lack of sleep is what gets me, you know, because I lose sleep already sometimes at work, let alone having nightmares. Waking up in the unit, turning around, seeing this thing at the glass, the roars, the screaming, the way this thing vocalized. And you're absolutely right, Bob, because this guy was the chief. This guy was the boss, man. From what he displayed to me, the machismo type of like, I'm here, you know. yeah, I could. This guy would try to establish he's the alpha male.
Yeah, I think it's interesting, too, your description of it swaying back and forth right before it rushed the ambulance. And Bob can probably go into this better than I can. But, you know, out of all of the encounters, out of all the people I've spoken to, when they do that swaying back and forth, you're on the edge of getting it handed to you at that point. It seems like whenever I've talked to a witness and they describe that swaying from side to side, usually right after that is when they usually something gets thrown at them. They get charged. Aggression happens right after that point. And I don't know. I mean, what's your take, Bob? It's almost like they got to work themselves up into to attack.
Well, I call it a frenzy. Where they're going back and forth from one foot to the next. I've seen them beat on themselves. I don't know if I can say this on your show, but they'll get real red faced, and they will even possibly get an erection. And it's blood flow. I know. I found that out later on. Talking with Tim and everything, because you know of what you know Tim does for a living. But, and also, you know, I've read a lot about Jane Goodall and everything. But what they're doing is they're working themselves up to attack the truck, to go through your windshield, to pull your pull you out of the vehicle. That's what it is. And the screaming and everything, it's like people say that, these things are half human and half this and half that and everything. Well, I got to tell you, when they get excited, and I'm talking about all of them, when they get excited, it's like standing in the monkey house where the apes and everything are. And listening to them scream bloody murder, and it's ringing in your ears. You can feel it in your chest. You can feel it through your body. Things in the pickup truck are shaking. That's how they work. That's how they work themselves up.
And you're right. I mean, it makes you think. Just like Joseph was saying, after it hit the truck, it was like a celebration. I'm sure that's the wrong term to use, but. You know, all of them were going off at that point.
And because they're excited. They're excited.
Yeah. Bob, I had a quick question for you. You think that it got thrown off because, when they saw the unit, the ambulance, the lights definitely helped save our lives. But do you think maybe also it was thrown off by what is this thing?
I'm sorry. Wes, what did he broke up really bad. Can you tell me what he said?
Yeah, what he was asking was, do you think the unit had some bearance on what happened? Is that what you're saying, Joseph? You're saying that...
Things like, well, what is this thing? It's blaring, it has lights, it's blaring noise. It's
I don't really think it had any bearing on what happened to you. I do think that the sound and the lights probably didn't help any at all. But what happened to y'all would have happened despite the lights and everything. like I said, it's probably what backed them off more than anything. Right. And yeah. Didn't you say that they were going around and around the vehicle also?
Yeah. The way after this thing initially, when they were celebrating, like, oh, you know, because that dude, that one was the alpha male. The big one had to be the alpha male. When these things were celebrating after their chiefs did something, or we're going to eat these guys for sure, whatever was going through their minds, it was like they're surrounding the unit. Different noises in different spots, the vocalizations were hitting the unit. Almost felt like the unit itself, from all the screaming and the racket it was making initially. And that lasted for about 60 seconds, man. These things are screaming and screaming and screaming.
They were working themselves up. They were working themselves up for the kill.
I just want the nightmares and the growls that I'm hearing to stop, to be honest with you. Is there anything that I can do? I'm asking you, and this takes a lot for me as a paramedic to ask you, but Bob, you know these things and you've helped dealt with these things. What can I do for myself to better me to get some of these things that I'm suffering from after going into these things to stop? Do you recommend anything?
Well, you know, after one bad time my son and I had, it took us 2 years to go back out into the woods. When we did, we just went to a campground. It was a primitive campground, but there were other people around. What we did was we kind of reintroduced ourselves. It took my son and I 2 years. After the female did her thing to us, it took us about 2 years to get back out in the woods because we were so traumatized. These things can traumatize you. And we had to reintroduce ourselves into the woods when we were doing it. We just went to took small walks and things of that sort. Basically, we just had to let it run its course out of our system, I guess you might say. Maybe a little PTSD, whatever, you know, you might say, but have to let it run its course.
And that's what it is. It's PTSD. That was exactly what's going on with me. I wish it hadn't happened, but I do appreciate you answering my questions about and Wes, because it took everything I had as a man. I felt sometimes, man, because this thing scared the Jesus out of me.
Yeah, and I think that's pretty natural. I think a lot of people go through that that feeling. You know, it doesn't matter how big and bad you are. You know, just ask the guys down at the biker bar, and they'll tell you that. I'm sure those guys, you know. But one thing I want to ask you, Joseph, is prior to the encounter, what was your feeling on these things?
I thought it was a joke. I didn't believe in it. I know years ago there was like a Gatorade commercial. And they showed all these things in life, like the climate of Mount Everest. So they would post fact, and then they showed, I believe, the passion footage, and they post proven fake. And I was always, I didn't believe in it. So there's no way something that big, that large, could sustain itself. But they are. That's the crazy part, is that they are.
Yes, they are.
And,
I think a lot of people see the Patterson film, like you and I were talking about, and they assume that's what they're going to run into. And,
right.
You know, it's very few witnesses I've talked to that said, yeah, it kind of looked like that. You know, most people, it's they'll say it kind of looks like that, but a lot uglier, especially
right.
Down there in Texas. You know, it's almost completely different than the Patterson film.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. It's a big animal that will hunt on us if they get an opportunity. Now that I've addressed it, what Bob has informed me of, and U.S., it just strengthens my point of view where I think they should be eliminated of. But I'm thinking it's not going to get eliminated of, because if they eliminate them, that means you have to recognize them. And if you have to recognize them, then it's going to cause a bunch of other trickle effects. The sad part about it is that the few people that have run into these things genuinely are kind of like a minority now.
to put on that jacket and say, okay, you know what? These things exist. Y'all want to call me crazy. You don't want to believe, that's fine. But I know push comes to shove. I'm not going to be so ignorant to the point I ever get in the woods again. I'm going to be eaten. If I ever go in the woods again, I'm going to go with at least a rifle, a handgun, and a shotgun.
Yeah. No, I hear you.
And you can bet your bottom dollar on it. If I get one of these things in my sight, I don't care if I have to shoot it in the head and then dig a hole and bury it myself. These things are not good. If it would have been a woman in the minivan with a flat tire with kids in the back, forget about it. Forget about it. And I'm an experienced paramedic, and I've gone through all kinds of situations where I got to keep my cool where other people lose their heads. And like I said, I credit myself for doing better than the average paramedic. And this thing then shook my foundation to the core.
Yeah, it'll do that. You know, it's interesting, the behaviors of these things. And I don't know, Bob, if you want to touch on this, but, you know, I think there is different types. You know, like what Bob was saying, you know, I think you were on the menu, you know, and sometimes you run into, or people in other parts of the country run into these things, and it's a completely different experience. It's a completely different behavior. They aren't so quick-tempered. They aren't so...
Right, not the ones down here. The ones down here, they don't play.
Yeah, the ones up north, typically, they don't usually mess with you too much. I think it's for me, I never really had any problems with them up north, you know, except for coming out and staring at me, stealing food and stuff like that. And I do know they have, you know, trouble with them on the reservations and things like that. But until I got down here, this was a whole different ball game, you guys. I mean, it really was for me down here when I started experiencing them down here. Whole different ball game. So volatile down here. I think everything's crazy in East Texas. even the bunny rabbits.
Yeah. I think the thing about it is it's the initial shot of fear. When you get struck with the fear and then you see this thing and your brain's kind of going through this weird phase of what is this thing that's going to eat me? It's viral. What's the wrong term? I'm sorry. It's visceral, rather. Sorry. It's visceral. It's visceral, the feeling that you get. I wish the whole thing wouldn't have ever happened.
Yeah, but, no, I hear you. It's, well, we're glad that you made it out okay. You know, like Bob says, and I tend to agree with everything he just said. I mean, I think that you're on the menu. I think that if you guys would have, and that's another good point. Maybe the audience doesn't pick up on it. I'm sure they do because I say it a million times.
Right.
When you're in these situations, don't run. No matter what happens, don't run. The moment you run, you become prey. It's like a cougar. I don't know if you've ever been stalked by a cougar. I know Bob has, but, you know, with a cougar, as long as you don't run, you're okay.
Right.
The moment you run, it's, you know, it loves to chase. It wants to chase you down. It wants to, it lives for the chase.
Right.
And I, like Bob was saying, you know, with these things, I think that's what it wanted you to do. I think it wanted you to get out of the van. And what set them off, though, in the beginning, I don't know. You know, and I don't know if Bob can answer that better, but I don't know what set them off in the beginning. I guess just being there.
Well, you have to assume that they were there when they had their flat tire. They were probably going to cross the road. They may have been hunting. And when they got out and they were working on their tire, I believe that's when these creatures decided, well, you know, this is an easy meal. And they have probably taken human beings before. To be honest with you, you know how I feel about it. I think these things have taken human beings many times before. And I think that's they put themselves on the menu basically by having their bad luck.
Yeah.
That's what I think, you know.
I wouldn't be surprised if these things have even taken people when they've had issues like flat tires. And then they go the next day, they would have just found a vehicle with the door open and a tire track and a cross and maybe a little bit of blood. But if someone were to ask me, someone close, someone I were to trust, hey, man, in all years as a paramedic, man, well, what was the hottest, craziest, almost lost your life situation? And if I had to be sincere with them, it would be that encounter with this humanoid freak that lives in the woods.
Yeah. Yeah, and I can't blame you. I can't blame you there. I mean, I think most people would feel that way. You know, the behaviors are very interesting. I know Bob and I are going to be working on a show coming up with the Albert Ottsman story.
Right.
And that's an interesting story in itself, but it just shows you the other side of the coin, that the behaviors, and coincidentally, that Albert Ottsman wasn't in Texas when this happened. So, I mean, it was up north, like Bob was saying, but it shows you the unpredictability of these things. You never know how they're going to react, and you just have to assume it's not going to be a good reaction, just like you do anything else while you're out in the woods.
Yeah, you're right, Wes. I agree. I think that I think they're kind of like they're slow. They're indecisive. Like when it was shifting its weight from side to side, it was maybe indecisive. These things, I don't even think they know how themselves they're going to react. I think they know viscerally how they're going to react. I think they know, okay, it runs, I'm going to eat. But I think when it gets to things a little more complicated, they are going to make a decision. But I think it's very chaotic. It's very chaotic in the things they do.
Well, Bob, did you have any more questions?
No, I really didn't. Actually, I did have one more question. Did you see the eyes? Could you tell me what the eyes looked like since you had it on the...
Sure,
right?
The eye. Yeah, no problem. Sorry, Bob.
Go ahead.
Eyes are red. I don't want to say beady, but compared to the rest of its body and its head, they were beady, but they're pronounced enough for you saw two big red eyes. They weren't round saucers or anything like that. They were like a chimp's eyes, kind of like a chimp's eyes, but yet humanoid, I guess humanoid in the eyebrow line, yet chimp in the whole overall shape. You know, the red. It was weird, man. It was weird because, you know, you if you go by and you see a cat's eyes at night, usually it involves some sort of light shining in it. But I think these things' eyes catch whatever light is around, and they project themselves red because the red eyes was a heart stopper, you know. yeah. And then being as ugly as they are. I mean, the mouth, the black mouth, the teeth, I haven't brushed his teeth in a decade. It looked like he lived a hard life. It looked like he lived a hard life, and it didn't care anymore, and wanted didn't mean us any good.
Yeah, it's snapping their jaws. That's aggressive, normal behavior for them. They were being aggressive.
Well, I know that I'm glad that I'm not going to work in that area pretty soon. My transfer came in, so that should be expected.
Yeah, I wouldn't want to go down that road either.
yeah. Bob, throughout the whole show, I don't mean to scare you. That's exactly what you're doing there, Bob. Yeah. To a certain extent.
Well, I don't think they were looking for a hug, so I think Bob's right on with that analysis.
Yeah, they weren't out Jones and Doug over there.
I tell you one thing, I bet you $10 you guys will probably, if you ever have another flat out on a rural road, y'all are probably just going to ruin the tire and the rim both, right?
I think if that were ever to happen, we're not actually in the truck at all. At all.
Yeah, the tire blowout, you guys will just keep on going.
we'll ride it till the freaking the sparks come out on it, man. We'll ride it till the wheels fall off, literally. I don't think the supervisor would be too happy about it, but hey, man, let him get eaten by one of these things.
I wanted to ask you, when you saw the red eyes, was that because of the what light did you have on it at that time?
We had the code 3 lights, and you could still see them with the floodlights as well. You could see the lights were always a constant. That was all about his eyes. Sorry, were always a constant. That's what, why I threw me off earlier, because I know that with basic animals, you can flash a light and then the eyes will shine. But this thing's eyes were shiny. It's like it was a, like it was a, adapted to it, or its eyes were red, like evil red. The shape of its eye was red. So it wasn't just round, perfect. It was a red eye. And I don't know if that was combined with it being suffering and struggling for life, or his eyes were bloodshot from stress or whatever. And then in addition, I had its red eyes. I don't know, but it was red.
Well, those that you are describing tend to have an orange color in their whites. And when we have blinded them, it does right. look red, but it's just, you know, it's shine from the light.
Right. Yeah. Well, the floodlights stayed on initially until it hit it, and then they flickered out. I think that their eyes are so adaptive to what they do, is that their whole body has been adapting to how they live. I just know that come through 5 a.m., I better have a shotgun, a rifle, and a handgun if I'm not going to. They should be shot, all of them, man. They're a nuisance.
Yeah, I understand how you feel, but they're not all like that. But the thing about it is that you never know with these creatures, because just when you think you understand their mind or understand them some, and they right. turn around and switch everything back up on you. You can be out there for a year,
right.
like I had, you know, prospecting and everything, and they, you know, don't ever bother you. But then all of a sudden, it's like you cross some kind of boundary or something, or they just got a sore tooth that day or something, and they're throwing rocks at you and everything else, and you know it's the same one or the
right.
same tooth, you know, and you got to get your butt out of Dodge, you know, because you're,
right.
you don't know what's going to happen to you. They're just very unpredictable creatures.
Yeah, all of them must have had a sore tooth that night, man. I must have caught them on one of the first nights. Or they must have had a bad time hunting or whatever. Or maybe the alpha one was arguing with the other one. I don't know, man. And we rolled up, and they're like, screw it all. Let's just get these idiots. Let's get these guys unlucky, unfortunate guys.
Yeah, well, I think you guys made the right decision in that whole night, you know, staying inside
the
vehicle, not freaking out too much. I think most people in that situation would freak out.
Right.
Although I have seen Bob in some crazy situations, and I think I told you before, Joseph, we had a log thrown at our head, and I couldn't tell if Bob just came from church or if we just had a log thrown at our head. His expression never changed.
Right.
And so, but, you know, some people are wired that way. Some people aren't wired to freak out, you know. Some people are wired to freak out in those situations, and so you never know. I think you guys did the right thing that night.
Thank you. I appreciate your input with that. Sometimes I double guess myself, maybe I can handle it differently, but I feel being a first responder, what I do helped a lot. I don't know if anybody else would have been out there. The natural instinct is to run. But not us, not that night, not the way it worked out for us. And I'm just happy to be alive, and I'm happy that it's over with.
I'm glad you're all right, too. I'd hate to see you being a statistic out there.
Yeah, that would not have been fun.
There have been so many.
Yeah, I can imagine. I think there's a bunch out there that aren't spoken about. I think it's probably running rampant out there, but it's not reaching the mass public. This whole stigma about it, people think it's, I was one of them too, like, that's a joke. And if it happens to me, then It's a different story.
Right. Right.
Well, let me do this, guys. Do you want me to, I can close this out, or do you guys, do you have any more questions, Bob, Joe?
No, sir. I don't have any more questions. Bob pretty much answered them all, and I answered them to where I'm satisfied with a lot of things I had, and I appreciate that, Bob.
Well, you're more than welcome. I hope I did you some good.
You did. You did. Definitely did. Yeah, you too, Wes. You as well. Thank you for the info, everything you've done.
Hey, thanks for coming on the show, Joe. I really do appreciate it. It's hard to get, especially first responder, to come on and share the encounter. And so thank you so much for coming on. And Bob, thank you again for coming on and giving us your feedback on it. Always appreciated. Always welcome, as you know.
Oh, you're welcome, Wes. I really do like it.
No, thank you, Wes. Thanks for letting me vent and stuff. I appreciate that.
Thanks, Joe. Thanks, Bob. And again, everyone, I'm working on the Albert Otzman story this week. It's been kind of time-consuming, but it should be a fun show. I'll be retelling the Albert Otzman story, and Bob will be joining me for that. If you've had an encounter, shoot me an email, wes@sasquatchchronicles.com. I hope everyone has a great night, and I'll see you next time. Some tone.